Well, good evening, everyone. We're going to begin our regular orders of business here in a couple of minutes, but we have a special order we'd like to work on first. Begin with a proclamation. Whereas a special election was held on the 14th day of March 2017, at which candidates for a certain office were voted upon, and whereas the results of the election have been recorded in the minute record of the council, and now therefore I, Chuck Bennett, mayor of the city of Salem, Oregon, proclaim and declare that at said election, Chris Hoy was elected councilor, Ward 6. Signed in Salem.
Raise your right hand. Please repeat after me. I, Chris Hoy.
I, Chris Hoy.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
And laws of the United States of America
and
of the state of Oregon.
And laws of the United States of America and the state of Oregon.
And the city charter.
And the city charter.
And ordinances of the city of Salem.
And the ordinances of the city of Salem.
And I will, to the best of my ability, faithfully and lawfully perform the duties, of city councilor for Salem, during my continuance therein. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Councilor Hoy.
Thank you.
Please call the roll call.
Commissioner Kazer?
Present.
Commissioner Anderson?
Likewise.
Commissioner Nanke?
Here.
Chair McCoy?
Here.
Commissioner Osick?
Here.
Commissioner Hoy?
Here.
Commissioner Cook?
Here.
Vice Chair Lewis?
Here.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, we have no additions and deletions to the agenda. Do we have any public comment? We have no public, nobody signed up to testify or speak to us of the Housing Authority. So is there anybody here who wishes to do so? Moving right along then, Commissioner Lewis, do you have a motion for us on the consent calendar?
Yes, I move passage of the consent calendar.
Moved by Commissioner Lewis, seconded by Commissioner Osick. Is there any discussion? Commissioner Lewis, do you want to talk to these?
Not at this point, unless somebody has questions.
Nope.
Okay. Chair McCoy?
I would like to ask Mr. Wiltz to comment a little bit about Yaquina Hall and how that's going and what the plans are with respect to that.
Pleased to do that, thank you. As you know, we've been working on Yaquina for the last 9 months, doing our due diligence to figure out if we had a project. We're also combining Yaquina, which we think will be 50 units, one bedrooms. We're combining that with another property that Salem Housing Authority owns in order to get the right mix of leverage for our investors, and really that's what this report tonight is about, funding to request of funding to Oregon Housing to help people that don't have a lot of opportunities in the world, serious mentally illness clients who we house every day. And so we're requesting up to 20 units of SMI across 92 units total. South Fair and Yaquina combined is 92 units. So that's about 23% population. And we're asking for up to $4 million to make the project work. As I said in the report, it's not easy to attract financing these days for affordable housing. Clearly, the market has shifted. Clearly, our ability to access Oregon housing funding, especially since the market shifted for them too, so they're backfilling other properties, other projects that came in before us. So we're confident we're going to be successful, but the market is certainly not what it was 6 to 8 months ago.
Okay. Okay, we got a motion by Commissioner Lewis, seconded by Commissioner Ossick to approve the consent calendar. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion passes. And that is it. So here I hereby close this meeting of the Housing Authority of the City of Salem.
Call this meeting of the City of Salem Urban Renewal Agency to order. If the recorder would please call the roll.
Board Member Kaser?
Present.
Board Member Anderson?
Present.
Board Member Nanke?
Here.
Board Member McCoy?
Here.
Board Member Ossick?
Here.
Board Member Hoy?
Here.
Board Member Cook?
Here.
Board Member Lewis?
Here.
Chair Bennett?
Here. Okay. Councillor McCoy, approval of additions and deletions. We have anything?
We have no additions, deletions to the Urban Renewal Agency agenda, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you. We have no one signed up for public comment. Is there anyone that wanted to address the Urban Renewal Agency? All righty, the consent calendar.
I move approval of the consent calendar.
Second.
Second by Cook. Is there any discussion?
There's two items on the consent calendar, Mr. Mayor. One of the minutes from the March 13th Urban Renewal Agency meeting, and the other is a resolution that amends the Urban Renewal Agency rules for scheduling meetings, gives a little more flexibility during the month. Instead of having two meetings a month when we don't need them, they can have it on any basically day of the month, but hopefully it will be in line with one of the council meetings. But it makes it much easier for them to conduct business when they need to and not have unneeded meetings.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Motion passes. Information reports. Does anyone want to? Ms. Rutherford, did you have anything you wanted to say on these? Okay. And we have no further business before the Housing Authority. Housing Authority is adjourned.
Just 5 minutes each. Keep it on a roll. Go for three.
I think we're
going to slow. I call this meeting of the Salem City Council for April 10th to order. If the recorder would please call the roll.
Councillor Kaser?
Present.
Counselor Anderson?
Here.
Counselor Mackey?
Here.
Counselor McCoy?
Here.
Counselor Ossick?
Here.
Counselor Hoy?
Here.
Counselor Cook?
Here.
Counselor Lewis?
Here.
Mayor Bennett?
Here. All righty. Do we have any additions or deletions? Counselor McCoy?
Yes, we do, Mr. Mayor. I move the approval of the, well, the revisions, actually, to the agenda.
Second by Ossick. You want to?
Well, it's a couple of revisions. One is 33B. There's a Scrivener's error in the subject. Misspell the word. And 33D, appointment to the Salem Art Public Art Commission. A report was added.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Okay, we have some proclamations this evening. Okay. Whereas the city of Salem is one of only 17 cities in the country to have been a charter participant in the Tree City USA program since 1976, and the first city in Oregon to receive a Tree City USA 41st Year Award from the Arbor Day Foundation, and whereas for the 41st consecutive year, the city of Salem has met the requirements for Tree City USA due to its urban forestry program supported by a minimum dollar per capita of public funds, tree ordinance, and formal Arbor Week activities. And whereas the city of Salem is also a sterling city with 11 Tree City USA growth awards in recognition of the city exceeding the goals established by the Arbor Day Foundation. Now, therefore, I, Chuck Bennett, Mayor of the City of Salem, do hereby proclaim the period between April 9th and April 15th as Salem's Arbor Week and encourage all people of Salem to participate in community, school, and private observances of Arbor Week during this week, dated this 20th day of March 2017. And I will present the proclamation to Jan Stachewski, the city's urban forester. And Jan, congratulations.
Thank you.
And then we also have, in conjunction with Arbor Week, we also have a special award for Cassia Quillinan. And so I'm going to turn it over to Jim Gersbach from the Oregon Community Trees, Oregon Department of Forest.
Thanks, Mayor Bennett. Well, it couldn't be more appropriate during Arbor Week to honor Cassia Quillinan, a Salem resident. She is the winner of our 2017 Individual Urban and Community Forestry Award given out by Oregon Community Trees, which is a statewide nonprofit recognizing urban forestry issues. A little bit about Cassia, her background. She's been an ardent advocate for trees in Salem for many years, supporting city staff in tree planting education and policies for protecting and enhancing the city's tree canopy. She was instrumental in helping oversee both the city's parks and appeals to city-owned trees as a member of the Salem Parks and Recreation Advisory Board. She did serve on your Citizen Advisory Committee, helping update the city's tree ordinances. And she is very active in her neighborhood association, inspiring and organizing tree plantings as recently as April 1st. So without further ado, Cassia, we'd like to present this 2017 Individual Urban and Community Forestry Award.
I'm about ready to tell you. I came to Oregon some 40 years ago as part of a tree planting crew. Exactly. This is a real hodad. I have kept it for a long time. Now, back in my younger years, I was able to go up Class 3 land, which is very steep, carrying this and 30 pounds of trees. Now I can barely get it up. So I'm going to have to start using it as weightlifting exercises, but that's what this is. So that's how I came to Oregon. I came to Oregon to plant trees, which I did. And since that time, my husband David, who's over here, and most of you know him, and I have planted trees along State Street. Many of you drive by those trees every day. We planted trees out at Minto Brown. We planted trees in Englewood. Some of the trees that we planted are now 30 feet tall, carried water all summer to make sure that they survive. Plus numerous trees around our own property. Most recently, as was mentioned last couple weekends ago, we planted trees out at McKay Park. So I really believe that trees are the answer to a lot of things. They're extremely healthy for the urban environment, for our climate in general, just for the beautification of the city. And so I urge you to plant a tree for yourself, plant a tree for the city, plant a tree for the world. Thanks.
Okay, our next proclamation, where's Krina? There she is. Whereas the people of Salem, Oregon are firmly committed to quality education and supporting academic achievement through community involvement, whereas for 35 years, the Salem Kaiser Education Foundation has raised money and distributed grants to classroom teachers for innovation and creative projects and programs. And whereas the foundation provides before and after school programs that help children develop relationships with caring adults and expand learning time while providing healthy, warm meals in a safe environment. And whereas the foundation inspires community engagement and volunteer efforts for student success. And whereas the City of Salem, Salem Kaiser School District, and the Salem Kaiser Education Foundation work together with common partners to provide programs and funding for Salem Kaiser youth. And whereas the Salem Kaiser Education Foundation is a catalyst for the enhancement of the education and development of all Salem Kaiser youth. Now therefore, I, Chuck Bennett, Mayor of the City of Salem, do hereby proclaim April 2017, Salem Kaiser Education Foundation Month. Whoa. And call upon the community to help ensure that every child, every day, has the opportunity to achieve greatness and realize their dreams, dated this 31st day of March 2017. Krina Lemons is here with us this evening. Krina?
Thank you so much. Very much appreciate this. I would like to introduce one of our board of directors, Mary Jean Sandel, who is also a previous administrator with the Salem Kaiser School District. And I have to say, it is an honor to do this work. We are just a catalyst for the passion of everyone because of you. Oh, Jackie's here. Jackie Frankie is another board of directors, just joined us. Thank you. But it is the passion of this community that makes sure that, just like the finish line at the Awesome 3000, where every child gets a standing ovation, we exist because of you to make sure every child gets that standing ovation across the graduation stage.
Thank you, Krina, very much.
I want a picture. Okay.
No.
I'll just shake your hand. How many people ran in the Awesome 3000?
I don't know. That's what you're here for.
How many of you ran in the Awesome 3000?
I have.
This year, in celebration of our 35th anniversary, we're having a reunion run. We'll see you at the start line.
Josh K., the only graduate, eh? Okay. And I have one more.
Okay.
Whereas every child deserves to live in a safe, loving, and caring family environment and be given the opportunity to thrive, learn, and grow to their full potential. And whereas in 2015, there were 10,402 reported victims of child abuse and neglect in Oregon. And of those reported cases, 823 were victims in Marion County. And whereas we endeavor to join together as individuals, organizations, and government agencies to prevent child abuse in our county by providing opportunities to educate, train, and support caregivers by raising awareness of relevant topics, including child development, basic care skills, discipline strategies, and goal setting for parents. And whereas by strengthening families and providing safe, stable, and nurturing environments that are free from violence, abuse, and neglect, opportunities are created for children's optimal growth and success, ensuring a secure future for our communities, where the needs of children are a priority and the needs of family are met. Now, therefore, I, Chuck Bennett, Mayor of the City of Salem, do hereby proclaim April as Child Abuse Prevention Month and ask the community to observe this month with programs and activities that help prevent child abuse and provide for children's physical, emotional, and developmental needs. And Chief, you're going to accept the proclamation. Thank you.
Well, I just want to say we live in a wonderful community, and as you know, my officers are very much involved in investigating and trying to take care of issues regarding child abuse. But we have some wonderful partners with DHS, our district attorney's office, and of course organizations such as Family Building Blocks and Liberty House. So it's a real team effort, and we're just proud to be a part of it. So thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much, Chief. Do any of the council members have any comments for the evening? Councilor Nanke.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just wanted to say on Friday evening and the bulk of the day on Saturday, I went through a ham radio class over at the Willamette University campus and was very surprised that one of the control operators was former Judge Gruber. And so I learned a lot over the weekend. Hopefully I'll be taking my test next Monday. I may have to leave Budget Committee a little early.
Great. All right, anyone else have comments? Yes, Councilor McCoy.
Last week, Councilor Cook and myself met out here on National Walking Day and took a walk to the new playground at the hospital there, which is a very cool place. Should have had that when we were kids. You can fall down and bounce back up. It's like there's no ground there. It's this rubberized mat down there under the playground. It was very great. Walked 1.8 miles in celebration of that, and I was still standing at the end. I was very proud of myself.
And
it was a good turnout and a worthy cause.
Councilor McCoy did keep up with my four-year-old and stay behind with me when she refused to walk. So I appreciate
Does anyone else have a comment? Councilor Hoy.
I would just like to say it's an honor to be here, and it's an honor to represent the residents of Ward 6, and I'd like to thank all of my friends and family and supporters who are here, people who helped me get here today. So thank
great.
You.
Great. Thank you. And anyone else? Yes, Councilor Kaser.
Just want to thank our Public Works employees who are out Friday and Saturday in force. Myself, I was a victim of a fence falling due to the storm, so I totally get all the work that everyone was doing, and it's very much appreciated.
Okay. Anyone else? I had the opportunity Saturday to join with associates and longtime employees of JCPenney's to celebrate their 100th anniversary here in Salem and congratulate them, to go down memory lane recalling my own arrival in Salem with a couple of bucks and a Penny's credit card so I could attend Willamette and be able to outfit myself on a regular basis. It was really delightful. They They have really served the downtown well. We are so lucky to have that and other department stores downtown. Many communities don't have that. It's a vital part of our downtown, and congratulations to the company and to the property owners for keeping that store vital in downtown. Okay. Public comment on agenda items other than public hearings. Okay, we have a pretty good list, so I'm going to ask you to please, if you would, not applaud. It just interrupts the flow of things. We're going to move this right along. Each of you have 3 minutes, and the orange light indicates you've just used two of them. When it comes on, the red light means literally stop talking. You're done, and it just helps if you do that rather than have me say, would you please stop talking, which I think becomes really annoying. So if you would do that, and if someone has said something that you've already, will be saying, you can certainly get up and just say, I agree. And it looks like everyone's here for 7.1B, and then I will have one other person speaking. Realize this is a first reading. This is your opportunity to speak to the issue. I would encourage you to encourage the council to advance it to second reading and a public hearing, which would occur at our next meeting, would be part of your testimony if that's your opinion, or vice versa. So stop now if you don't want this to go forward. So I'm going to begin with Sean Johansson. And after you, Sean, is Elizabeth Gill, and both of these podiums work. And if you'd introduce yourself and your ward or your address, whichever you prefer. Sean, go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor Bennett. My name is Sean Johansson. I am a resident of Ward Number 3. I'm here today to encourage the council to move forward with line item 7.1B with support of the TNC and rideshare network companies. Myself, I've lived in Salem for 7 years now. The council may remember last year I stood before you and asked you to help protect the Sunny Slope Gardens, and I want to take this moment to thank you. It is a wonderful opportunity to be able to live in Salem and still keep a garden even though I have an apartment. Since that time, I have taken a new position and started driving with Lyft part-time on the side. I actually drive up to Portland every weekend. I do about 22 hours because there was some unfortunate damage to my vehicle in a parking lot, and I had the option of about $2,200 in repairs or a $500 insurance deductible and an increased rate, which I couldn't afford either. After talking with my wife and looking into temporary jobs, second jobs, and things of that nature, which all were very hard for our schedule because of the weird hours I keep working East Coast hours at my current job, the topic of rideshare came up. At that time, Lyft was offering a bonus for new drivers. If you signed up and completed a certain number of rides, there was a $500 bonus for the city of Portland. Well, that was an answer to prayer. I decided, after not taking too much time to really think about it, because it was all very clear to us, that was the only way we're going to be able to pay to fix our car. So I went to my local mechanic here in Salem. I had him fix the damage, and then I had 30 days to come up with a way to pay for it. Lyft provided that for me. I've now been driving. What started out as just a means to an end to pay for car repair ended up becoming a bit of a passion and a godsend because, as I mentioned in the last time I was for this council, my wife is unable to work for medical reasons. On one day she's doing wonderful, the next day she may not be able to get out of bed and barely go around the house. And so there's no way she could work, so we were a single family income and still are. Lyft has provided us the opportunity to put our vehicle into a service, and in the last year, pay off all of our credit card debt. We've now even taken it to the next level and invested in a new minivan, which has allowed me to increase my income while driving about a third while paying for the van, and I'll have it paid off in about a year instead of five. It's provided a great opportunity, and also one for my wife for the days when she's feeling well, she'll be able to drive and start earning some income. And I all know about 5 to 6 people here in Salem as well that have signed up or want to sign up, but most of them are not able to make it to Portland because they already have children, which I don't. So they aren't able just to, you know, go up, get a hotel room, and stay away from their families for 3 days to pay the bills. So I would encourage you to move this ahead. I did have an interesting encounter with my father-in-law as a former Salem taxi driver. I'll leave him nameless for the sake of I didn't get his permission to use it, that he was scared I'd be under a lot of danger because he was assaulted and stiffed on fares numerous times while driving. And I'm very delighted to report once it comes to Salem, he's interested in starting to drive because he's seen how safe it is.
Thanks, Sean, very much. Thank you for coming down. Were there any questions? Okay, Elizabeth. And then following Elizabeth is Jim Bauer.
Hello, my name is Elizabeth Gill. I'm the current student body president at Willamette University. And I'm here representing the students of Willamette. And I encourage the council to continue this resolution. There has been a general consensus, the students we've talked to as our student body government, that this would really benefit the students of Willamette getting to and from campus in an affordable way. Other than that, I'll keep my remarks very short. Thank you for having me. And if you have any questions for me later on, I'd be happy to answer. Thank you.
Were there any questions for Ms. Gill? Great, thank you very much. Congratulations on being student body president. Following Jim Bauer is Nick Williams.
Hi, excuse me, Jim Bauer, 1866 Merritt Street, Salem. Councilor Cook is my city council person. I'm here today to encourage you to move this forward. Willamette University, I mean, we have our student body president here. She doesn't come down to city council meetings very often, but this is something that's important to our students. In our case, we get asked this question all the time. Why don't you have Uber? Why don't you have Lyft? Why don't you have these things in Salem? And I guess the point is to move this forward so we can know whether we should or should not have it. But I think our community of prospective students, our community of faculty and staff, all have opinions about this, but I think want to be able to have that opinion heard in the public process, which is what we're doing today. And so I encourage you to move it forward and hope that when the time comes that we can have a community dialogue about the benefits of this, you'll understand that for Willamette, for people who are coming here from outside of our area, they expect this. They don't understand why we don't have it. So thank you. Happy to answer any questions. Congratulations, Councillor, for your election.
Thank you. Okay, any questions for Mr. Bauer? Okay, Mr. Williams, and then Mustafa Kamar.
Mayor Bennett, councilors, my name is Nick Williams. I reside on Caribou Court in West Salem, and I also serve as the Chief Operations Officer for the Salem Area Chamber of Commerce. Tonight I'm wearing my personal hat, though. The city of Salem is we're experiencing a very robust economic expansion. People are moving here in droves. There was a study that was recently done by LendingTree, and LendingTree found that when they take a look at metrics having to do with real estate transactions as well as new business startups and actually increased cultural diversity, year over year, Salem is the most improved city in these categories. And as a result of that, what that tells is that people are moving here. So what we need to pay attention to as a body and as a community is the kind of people that we're attracting to move here. And the folks that are potentially looking at Salem as a community to live, is it a car that they have to have, or is it a community that they have to have a car in, or is it a community that they can move to and live car-free? As Mr. Bauer just explained, with college students, there are a number of folks that want to live without a car. And I think as a community, we're in a good position with this particular ordinance that's being considered to be able to help those people find Salem as a good place to live. Personal story: when ride sharing was being offered in Salem. A couple of years ago, I could take, at the time, Uber from my house downtown and back to my house for about $12 and about 20 minutes total waiting. I tried the same thing with a local cab company. It was about $30 and a little over 2 hours waiting. So that's the disparity in time and in cost that people experience time over time. So thank you for considering this. Councillor Hoy, congratulations, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Any questions? Thank you, Mr. Williams. Mr. Parr.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm also a Willamette student. I'm at the MBA program, and I'm not here to support or be against ride sharing, but I want to consider my research that I have done through the MBA program at the business school under the supervision of Professor John Thompson. So I did a cost-benefit analysis of how can implementing the ride sharing benefit the city of council or not benefit the city. And I focused specifically at the area of safety in terms of reducing the DUI incidents or accidents, and found out through the conclusion of my research, basically without stating too much details, that having a cheaper option for the residents of Salem might give another option for people who want to go out on maybe a Saturday night, not using their own cars, and having an option, a cheaper option for them than the regular taxi companies when they want to come back home. So if I want the city to consider how can a Lyft or an Uber be a cheaper option, or else we found out through our research that it might not be of a benefit in reducing these DUI incidents. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is your paper available? Or I mean,
it's under process. Yeah, I have four components. I'm gonna be done after in a month. Oh. And I'll have the project by the end of the month.
Be very interesting to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Tommy Walker and Zachary Wright.
Hello, I'm Tommy Walker. I work for KeyBank. I'm president of the KeyBank Young Professionals Group, and I'm here today. I live in West Salem, by the way, at 760 Northwest Hope Avenue. I'm here today just really urging that we continue to talk about Uber. We continue to advance that conversation. I think, like most young professionals, I was really surprised to find out that we didn't even have Uber. I mean, it wasn't until I downloaded the app, tried to actually get a ride, that I realized that we don't even have it. It's just one more way that we can make doing business here in Salem easier. And I'm for one for that. I love everything we're doing downtown. We're really starting to be somewhere that's really encapsulating young professionals and bringing those people here, so that we can continue to grow Salem. And this is just one more way that we can do that. Like I said, most of us young professionals, we just think that it's just there. It's everywhere. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Any questions? Okay. Mr. Wright.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for having me. I'm a resident of Ward 8. and to sort of piggyback off what everyone else is saying, I think with some of the expansion in downtown and some of the folks that I associate myself with, one big thing that we're passionate about is, you know, we've got great university, which is developing professionals in our area. And retention of those professionals to continue to grow and develop Salem is important. And we feel that having something like Uber or Lyft to drive business to Salem, visitors to Salem, would really help in that development. So like I said, piggybacking off of everyone else in favor of it, and thanks for having me.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Okay, thank you. Kirsten Garber and Aaron Wakefield.
Hello, I live in Ward 5. And
say your name.
Oh, Kirsten Garber.
Thank you, Kirsten.
Yes. And I'm an Uber driver, and I drive to Portland as somebody else, our Lyft friend. And I would totally stay in Salem if I could. I live here, and I chose to live here. And I'm a musician, an artist. I do body work. I recently moved here less than a year ago, and trying to get my new world and my shingle hung and just put my name out there as to what I do. I teach privately, and Uber has been my momentum. And if it hadn't been for Uber, I didn't have any investment that I had to give other than I have a good car. All right, I can go to Portland, and now I have income. And I meet amazing people, and I would offer myself more to the community of Salem if I didn't have to go to Portland to do what I do, right? And I'm getting a lot of business for all of my things that I do in Portland. People say, oh, you do Alexander Technique. Oh, you're a violin teacher. Can you come to, I can, you know, it's like, well, I live in Salem. So it'd be great if I could have wives who hear what I do. Oh, you teach violin. My kid's five. I'll, you know, that kind of thing. So it would be wonderful to have that kind of interaction with my own peeps right here. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Anyone with kids needing violin lessons?
Yeah.
Okay. Aaron Wakefield. Are you okay? Pam Kniffen.
Okay, I'm Miss Reality. I'm a mom. I'm here to talk as a parent. Pam Kniffen, 3773 Cheviot Way. I have no idea what ward I'm in. Sorry, I used to be ahead of one of these things. I used to be, okay, anyway, I'm here to talk to you about safety and accountability. Safety, I have 420-somethings that like to spread money around downtown in the evenings, and they have no way to get home safely. I am shocked. Not every policeman is here tonight to say we need ways to get our people home safe from our bars. Do you want them to go down and spend money downtown? Of course we do. But they have no way to get home safely. They wait hours and hours and hours for a cab. I guarantee you. Believe me, I'm the cab. They call me. And then on top of that, this is an accountability issue. When I was in San Francisco with my daughter, who I talked to all the Uber drivers, which drive her crazy, but that's beside the point, they say it's accountability, that not only do you know who your Uber driver is, they know who you are, they know if you've had any problems with any other drivers, they rate you as much as you, so you rate them. So both of you, if you screw up in that car, that Uber driver's gonna give you a bad rating and you'll never get another ride. And the same thing goes for the Uber drivers. If they're not polite, they beg you for a five. When you get out of that car, they beg you to write a nice comment and give them a five, because that is what they need. It's all about accountability. There's accountability from the driver and accountability for the riders. And that, to me, as a mom who has a daughter living in San Francisco, she used to be on the streets for hours trying to get home. Now she waits in her apartment. He's right out front. She locks her door. She sees him. She identifies him. She's got the license plate. She's got the driver name. She's got everything about him. He's got everything about her. And then, like you say, and I asked these Uber drivers, and they said they all left being cabs because they were scared and they had bad experiences with riders. And so this is an accountability issue for them too. So anyway, as a mom, I beg you to consider this. So have 420-somethings that live in this city or come to the city and love to go visit your bars and have no way to safely get home. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
Oh, sorry.
Guess not. Thank you. Chip Conrad.
Mr. Mayor, hello. I'm just pretty much going to echo what everybody's been saying here. I think when I moved to this town 9 years ago, Chip Conrad, 241 Equestrian Loop, just moved there. Great, nice house. when I moved here to Salem 8 years ago, it was a small city, and people thought that, and now it's not that anymore. There's a lot of people that are moving here. It's a very attractive city. It's all grown up. And I think this is just one of the things we need to add to continue to grow the city in the right direction.
Any questions for Mr. Conrad? Okay, thank you very much. Joshua Kay.
First city council meeting for me, so a little bit nervous.
But I was trying to be here on time, but I missed my cab, I missed the bus, and the nearest Uber I could find was 55 miles away. So it was unfortunate. Anyways, just joking. My name is Josh Kay. I'm from Ward 3, 2074 Salina Ave. I'm here tonight with my wife, Lillian. I'm an Uber user, and I've utilized the app on two different continents, Los Angeles, Portland, and it was great for me, and it worked out without a hitch. Four things, I'm going to echo what everyone else is saying tonight. Convenience, it's economical, it creates jobs, and frankly, it's good for our local economy and downtown. Mrs. Niffen, I was with your son out at St. Patrick's Day. Luckily, we had a designated driver. But we wish we would have had an Uber. That would have been great. And Sean and Aaron. Aaron's an Uber driver. Sean's a Lyft driver. They have to drive to Portland to do it. I think we can keep them in Salem. January 12th, 2017, the Statesman Journal posted an article, and they took a poll. 64% of people polled said yes for a ride-sharing program. 36% of people said no. Now, of the 36% of people that said no, 20% don't like Uber or Lyft business practices. 8% of people said they'd vie with public transportation. And 9% of people said they'll just drive themselves. Well, I'm going to drive myself too, but there's instances where I'm going to be calling for an Uber to take me or a Lyft to take me. So there is a quote that I wrote down here from the mayor of London. Now, obviously, London's a lot more people, different culture, but it's important I think we hear it. Boris Johnson, the mayor of London, recently told a group of taxi drivers the following: "You are dealing with a huge economic force, which is consumer choice, and the taxi trade needs to understand that. I'm afraid it is a tragic fact that there are now more than 1 million people in the city that use the Uber app." When cabbies protested that their prices were being undercut, Johnson replied, "Yes, they are. It's called the free market." So this isn't a matter of the business practice, and I know that there's social requirements as well and law that we need to follow, but I think that we need to find a creative way to allow ride sharing to exist here in Salem, because I think it's going to benefit all of us, our businesses, our people, our public safety. I think it's going to be a great thing. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kay. Any questions?
Well said.
Great. Thank you. Thanks. Very much. Al Wakefield.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor, Council members. My name is Al Wakefield. I'm in Valley Yellow Cab. First thing we need to address here is in January, Councilor Anderson moved to change the motion Monday to say that the city staff would reach out to the taxi companies on the matter to form an opinion on which way to go with this to make everything equitable, which the city councilors approved. I think that we'd approve something here. It's the responsibility of the city to make sure that it's carried out, not to bypass it over and listen to these fine folks talk. I mean, they're all great, but under the Massachusetts revision, they went through and recently audited the Uber and Lyft drivers' background checks, of which over 12% failed. And it's here. California, Nevada, and several other states are currently looking to support and revise the background information for the drivers. You're all familiar with this. I'm sure that the drivers and representatives here are very fine folks, and we're not going to take away from them. And one thing we got to take a look at is the smoke and mirrors that Uber's doing right now. They're, you know, we have bills in the legislature which make every bit of this mute in about 2 months, so all your efforts could be over with. So I think everything needs to be put on hold till the legislature has it seen. And let's see, what else do I have to say about that? Oh, also, it's also a ploy, because in the legislature, the bill that Uber's trying to pass has the wording contradictory to our own Department of Labor of the state that they be announced as independent contractors, where the state has already said that Uber is an employer. Since they can't contract and set their own rate, they can set their own hours. Seattle's voted to unionize, allow unionization of Uber. Uber says, I'm going to pull out. Well, you know, what I say, if you're going to pull out, what good have you done for the community? But I think this needs to be resolved, you know, through the legislature first before bringing it through the city, but also that city staff needs to work with local companies to make sure it's equitable and fair to all parties. Yes, Mr. Anderson.
Councilor Anderson.
Oh, yes, sir.
Well, you go.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. You drive the cab now, huh?
The mayor's in charge.
Yeah.
I guess I have two questions. The first one is, you haven't been contacted by anybody in the staff in looking at this ordinance?
No, sir. We've never been contacted by any city staff members. We had never been informed of this meeting until we found out about it. But evidently, all the Uber people and Lyft people have been pre-talked to about it before. I mean, we just found out about it today.
I would
and
ask.
And that's because somebody read it up on the on Facebook, and where the mayor did a video riding in an Uber car telling him how great it was.
I've never been in an Uber car.
Well, I'd ask the city manager.
Was it in the vehicle?
Mr. Wakefield. I would ask Mr. Powers if at least before the next, it looks like we're moving toward a public hearing, if somebody could from the staff could contact Mr. Wakefield and the other, I'll just say old style transportation companies. Yeah, before. Then the other question I have, and this relates to something we spoke about at some of the last meetings. It seemed in our first ordinance what the city wanted to do was, let's say the cab companies are up here, they wanted to bring Uber up to there, but what it looks like is happening now is Uber's down here and they're bringing, the city ordinance would bring the cab companies down to the lower level with Uber. I just wonder if you have any comment about you having the lower level requirements on some things than you do right now.
Our company has professional drivers. They're all trained, they're all properly commercial insured. All our vehicles are maintained by an SASE certified mechanic. We're professionals. And when you haul people around, I believe as a transportation system, you should be a professional. You know, if you do a 21-year-old is not a professional driver, I'm sorry. They may know how to drive, but they're not a professional. All our drivers are trained in CPR, first aid. We carry first aid equipment, fire extinguishers, and everything for the safety of our passengers and our vehicles, including full dispatch contact, where the driver is in contact in safety positions at all times.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any further questions?
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you. Oh, okay.
So when you were here last time and we talked about this moving forward, can you talk about any of the preparations that your company has done? I know there's been some discrepancies as far as waiting time on cabs or feedback on ratings. Have there been any steps that you've taken in preparation for this moment?
Not exactly. We're doing basically business as usual because we are professional. We have a good training program which spends hours. Our cab company is nationally certified by the National Transportation Safety Board. We have on-site employees that are trained for passenger safety and assistance programs. We are nationally certified. We have a nationally certified instructors for safe driving classes and also for diversionary classes. Those are the things we do that, in that respect. But as far as any other special preparation, no, we want, we think that the, and we know we shouldn't just say, we know the citizens of Salem deserve the professional transportation that they're getting. I mean, sometimes we're sitting now, we'll have 10 or 12 cars, 13 cars out on the road, and six or seven of them will be sitting in Salem the way it is today. I know that in the city of Portland, they have over 4,000 Uber drivers just hanging around town waiting for somebody to ping them. There's 60 to 80, 100 of them sitting in the airport waiting for the next ride. And, you know, we got good, honest, taxpaying people who are earning a family living wage, and by cutting some of this out will be detrimental to them as well. And like I said, the last meeting, 40% of every dollar goes south. Here, when you support the local economy and the people here, all 100% of that dollar stays here and supports the local economy.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Any further questions?
Any other questions?
Thank you, Mr. Wakefield.
And then anybody would be, you're certainly welcome to come down and take a look at our operation. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And then I'm going to take one other, Ryan McGinney.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Probably already know I'm Ward 4, and anyways, I'm here to talk about, I have a list of recommended, so I'm going to pass these out. So I have a recommended street tree list for the city of Salem and an approved street tree list for Eugene. Now, give or take, Eugene is possibly, I would say, about the same size or maybe more than Salem. On their approved list that they have, most of them are deciduous trees, but on their approved list are ones that I've never seen before. And for instance, I would point out Quercus virginiana, which is cathedral live oak. And those tend to have a spread of about 30 feet. So as far as I know, Jan, I've talked with Jan, and he said, you know, do we really want lollipop trees, you know, flowering trees? He said, is that really going to, you know, make our canopy denser in the communities? Well, most of the trees that are on the Eugene list are trees that spread of 30 feet, and so that would give the neighborhoods more denser canopies. And I think we need to look into more different types of trees. If Eugene can have these kind of trees that are originally from the south, and I don't know, they have one there from the Channel Islands. But I think we can, you know, get unique with it.
Okay. Thank you, Ryan, very much. Are there any questions for Ryan? Okay, that's everyone signed up. Is there anyone else who wanted to speak on any of the items tonight? Yes, please.
My name is Yvonne Tamayo. I live on Fairmont Hill, 1755 John Street. And I just wanted to speak very briefly about Uber and my experience here in Salem with taxis and Uber. I'm a law professor at Willamette Law School, and I drive myself. I drive pretty much everywhere. And so the only time I would take a taxi or an Uber is if I'm traveling, and I would take a taxi to the hut, or if my car is being worked on. On those occasions, I have to take a taxi. And my experience with taxis here has been unfortunate. I would say I've had taxis just not show up at 2:45 in the morning when I have to make the 3:15 hut, and I call and they say, we don't have your request, which I know I made the day before. I've had taxi companies say, there's a 45-minute wait, and I'm not partial to any company. I've tried them all. And something that may not have been brought up in these discussions is, on at least two occasions, I've gotten into a taxi and smelled just dense cigarette smoke. One time it was fresh, and one time it was a very stale smoke. The one time where I say it was fresh, it seemed like someone had just gotten out of the taxi before me and had been smoking in the car. And so I asked the driver about it, and I said, were you smoking right before you picked me up? He was very nice, and he said, no, but my passengers smoke. And I said, it's legal to smoke in taxis in Oregon? And he said, you know, if they couldn't smoke in the car, I'd probably lose half my customers that I pick up from bars and places. And honestly, the smoke was so dense in the cab that if I would have had a baby or a child, I would have gotten out. Unfortunately, there was nowhere for me to go, and it was raining. So I was alone, and I stayed in the car. The other time, a taxi picked me up from the hut to bring me home, and it was just a very stale smell of smoke. And I said, do you smell stale cigarette smoke? And he said, no. And I said, oh, well, I definitely do. And as I leaned forward a little bit to talk to him, I realized it was from his coat. And so I wound up lecturing him on the way home about the virtues of washing your coat every once. So again, he was very pleasant and very receptive, I guess.
Great. Thank you very much. It's the light turned red.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone have any questions? Okay. Did you want to speak?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Hello, my name's Anne Marie Garber, and I'm in Ward 5. And so I just want to echo what some of the people have said and some topics that if you've never used Uber or Lyft that you may not know about. So I've traveled a lot in my life for work usually, and one time, I'm going to start this with this personal story, it won't last long. I was in Vegas, and basically the cab driver asked me, do you want to go the quick way or the long way? And it was 1 o'clock in the morning. I just got off a plane after 6 hours of flying. I said, just get me to my hotel. And come to find out, I ended up paying $12 more than my colleagues did going to the same convention because the fast route was going through some toll bridge that cost $6. He did not make me aware of that. And the reason I bring that up is because when you use Uber or Lyft, it's all on an app, and it tells you exactly, well, not exactly, but approximately how much that ride's gonna cost. I also spent time in China, and taking a cab in China, regardless of the language barrier, you can easily get ripped off. They will negotiate with you, and not in a good way, to take you across town, and you end up paying two or three times more. I don't think we have that problem here, but it is a concern. So with the Uber app, you're able to see exactly how much it's going to cost you. The other thing is, in this day and age, we are so afraid of having our personal identity stolen. And if we're not afraid of it, we should be, because our credit cards are everywhere and we have information on the internet. The nice thing about Uber is that I'm an Uber driver on weekends. I work in Salem, I live in Salem, and I go to Portland to drive on the weekends. I really enjoy it,
but I never see any money unless someone tips me, which is super, super nice. But that doesn't always happen. But I never see their credit card. I never see anything that I could steal to take their identity. And when you have money exchanging hands, you know, it wasn't that long ago that there were, I lived in Anchorage and this happened, where cabbies were being robbed for whatever cash they had in their car. And there is none of that in Uber or Lyft because all of it is electronic. There's no exchange of money. And there was some talk about accountability, and that's true because everything is on GPS. I know exactly where my rider is, and my rider knows exactly where I am at all times. That's constantly being tracked. And supporting Uber drivers is supporting the local community. You're not going to have people from Portland driving to Salem to drive for Uber, but you are going to have the ones who drive up to Portland on weekends staying here and being part of the community and keeping that money here locally. And that is all that I have.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Councillor McCoy, the consent calendar.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I move approval of the consent calendar with the following polls. Item 3.2A by Councillor Kayser and item 3.3A by Councillor Lewis.
Second by Nanke. Do you want to go through the
calendar? The other items on this consent calendar are the minutes of the last council meeting. And we've got 3.3B, which is authorizes the city manager to enter into an intergovernmental agreement with the Salem-Keizer School District for the school district's use of the city's right-of-way for the placement of telecommunication system facilities within the city's right-of-way. In other words, their fiber optic network that's going to connect all the schools in the district. And 3.3C is from the legislative committee, and it's their recommendation that approve the legislative positions and priorities as recommended by the council's legislative committee. That's it.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor of the consent calendar say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. Okay, we'll go to a public hearing. Councillor McCoy, this is I'm going to have you now. I'm sorry. Do you want to go ahead and announce it?
This is a continuation of a public hearing concerning Ordinance Bill 15-11 relating to solid waste.
Okay, thank you. Councillor McCoy.
We are the public hearing.
It's your motion.
Yep. I move to close the public hearing and table consideration of the item until any member of council direct staff to place the item on a future council agenda for council's consideration.
Second.
Second by Austin.
Speak to them. This is an item that's been going along for 6 years. This has been a six-long issue on a public meeting that's been put off for 6 months, and it has to do with the delivery of flyers by the local newspaper for those folks that frankly don't take the paper. It's caused problems in the past with clutter and winds blowing them around, and they're not dropped in the right place, and people are getting them that don't want them, and they call and try to get out of it. So for the last 6 years, this has sort of been hanging over their head like a threat that, you know, if they don't get clean your act up, there's something here we'll do with an ordinance to have you do it. It's been fairly effective, but on the as the city staff has recommended, my motion would basically say, hey, we're going to close the public hearing. And what we're going to do is anytime somebody wants to bring it up or if it becomes an issue again because the folks aren't handling it properly, we can bring it right back up and readdress it then. So that's what the motion does. It closes a six-year public hearing, which is one way to do it, but probably not the best way to be going about doing our business.
Councillor Cook?
I would want to speak to this motion because this just came up in our ward this past month, especially with the torrential rain. And I would ask department head Fernandez to weigh in on the storm drains, and especially with the amount of rain. Part of the concern that came up in our ward was we're already trying to dig out of the leaves, and now we've got wet papers, and how do we handle this? So not necessarily moving to close, but maybe second hearing or, yeah.
You're next. Okay. Mr. Fernandez.
Thank you, Mayor. Peter Fernandez, Public Works Director. Yeah, litter can be a problem, and paper especially can be a problem in clogging storm drains, especially small ones. We're on a sweeping schedule for most neighborhoods. Downtown gets swept quite a bit, but as we get out to the farther edges, neighborhoods sometimes only get a couple of sweepings a year once leaf season is gone. So we really encourage folks to be catch basin rangers, not just during leaf season, but throughout the year to clean out the grates that are near their homes. You know, it's litter like anything else. So this is, I think, the issues that have been attempted to be addressed with this public hearing. This issue is precisely that, so that it isn't litter around that, but it can be a problem. But that's not just this. Any litter can be a problem on a storm drain.
Thank you,
Councilor Nanke.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, this has gone on for quite a while. My question, because I was contacted by a Ward 3 resident, but the staff report said we've had no formal complaint. So it's his,
complaint? Steve Power, city manager. It is a formal complaint. It came in after the staff report was prepared.
Yeah, and again, the main issue with some of those people is, if there's one lane in my driveway for a week, and then there's now two in my driveway, people get the perception that you may not be at home and you may be out traveling. So and that was his concern as well, that it basically is a red flag or a green light for criminal activity on your residence. So, but it sounds like we are getting better. It'd still be, I'm assuming we're still tracking it no matter what, even if the public hearing isn't, you know, an ongoing, and if we saw a reversal, we could kick it back in.
Okay. Councilor Kasem.
Thank you. I remember when this came up initially, in Ward 1 especially, it was quite the problem, and especially with the Statesman Journal Wednesday paper not making it at all onto the property. And then in vacant homes, especially during the economic mm-hmm. downturn, they were just piling up in vacant homes, to your point, Councilor Nanke. Recently, I will testify, it seemed a lot better. So the outreach that Brady, you're doing, and city staff seems to have an effect, and perhaps the Statesman Journal has been more receptive to hearing when you want to be removed from the list, remove you from the list, and communicate that out to their deliverers as well. So. Personally, I haven't heard of it come up at neighborhoods recently. I do see it still, where the person delivering those things just can't quite make it off the street to their porch. But as long as we have a process in place, and it sounds like we do, to report that, then I'm fine with closing it.
Okay. Any further discussion?
So if there are further complaints, it will just be the same process. Nothing will change in closing this hearing.
Well, if I understand the motion correctly, you can bring it back up anytime, and this could be brought back to the agenda. It's leaving it open for you to bring it up. What we've been doing is just every 6 months, it comes up automatically, whether anything's going on or not. And what this will become more now is kind of complaint driven. If you've got enough complaints, you feel that you want to bring this up, you can bring it up. I brought this up 6 years ago, and I've been doing this every 6 months. We talked about it this morning, and I felt like it's time to let someone else start. It showed up in my neighborhood this week too. I saw it.
You saw complaints in your neighborhood?
No, I saw it laying out in someone's yard in my neighborhood. And I thought your question about the drain was quite good.
Well, especially in my ward, given the slopes, in the area, and the tree canopy, which is wonderful, this time of year is especially problematic.
Yeah.
And people don't always know that it's the Wednesday freebie, unless it's at the house with the for sale sign where there's, you know, a few of them. It's something that has just surfaced again, and so I'm a little bit remiss to close it since people may not have been aware that we've got it on there.
What you could do is just put it on your calendar to tickle it in 6 months, see if you want to bring it back, or rather than the main thing was it has the staff do a recurring staff report. It comes and we don't know if there's complaints. We've had several years with really no complaints.
And no complaints to the city, that is. Not a follow-through process with the Statesman Journal.
They tend to report the declining number of complaints. You notice they don't even show up anymore, unless Jonathan's going to testify. Jonathan, are you up for testifying on this? Okay. Heard that before. Okay. Ray, go. Go ahead.
What's being done now as far as tracking it and having the Statesman Journal report to the staff, and if you look at the staff report, the findings, the number of people complaining is down, the requests are down for taking it off, all those things are involved, as the staff report says. Changes have been made to more accurately manage the program. That's still all in place.
Not going to go away.
That's not going away. All we're getting rid of is this ongoing six-year.
Okay,
open
so we're
hearing.
Just getting rid of this part.
We're just tabling this until somebody says this is an issue again, and we'll bring it right back up.
All right, thank you.
Okay. Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Motion passes. Okay, we're to special orders of business. Councilor Kaser, 3.2A.
I move staff recommendation.
Go ahead.
Councilor, you want to speak to your motion?
I do. Let me really quickly pull it up here. Thank you. I had my own notes here.
Luddite to the rescue.
I know. Essentially, in the staff report, it says for this resolution it would be subject to six different things, essentially. In the first two of those, so this is on page 2 of the staff reports under facts and findings, says resolution number 2017-24 delegates city manager to authority to apply for and accept grants. Subject to, the grant's objectives are consistent with city policy, the grant's resources help implement city services. Now, those two objectives are not reflected in the resolution. And talked with city manager this morning about this, and I think just a simple amendment to include those things would suffice. But I don't know if this was included in the resolution before, but it seems like good sense that the grants you're applying for would align with council goals and implement city services. So just to make that clear, I think we should add those things in.
Would you like to make that?
So I'd like to move to amend my motion.
Okay.
Yes. Which would be to adopt the recommendation with the amendments to include the two facts and findings, I guess, which would be, or the two criteria, which would be the grant's objectives are consistent with city policy and the grant's resources help implement city services.
I second.
Second by Cook. Okay. And you pretty well spoken to it. All those in favor of the, unless there's further discussion. Okay, everybody got it? Okay, this is a vote on the amendment. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, motion passes. Now to the amended motion.
Nope.
We're fine. Any discussion on the amended motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. And Councilor Lewis, 3.3A.
Yeah, I'm going to move a staff recommendation on agenda item 3.3A.
Second.
Second by McCoy. Councilor Lewis.
I have one question. I'm not sure who to ask, so I'll just throw it out. But the agreement with Mountain West makes it pretty clear that the city has a responsibility to maintain the fountain in good working condition. My question is, the city's responsibility is spelled out pretty clearly, but there's no financial amount, so I'm curious what that annual expense would be.
Mr. Fernandez?
Thank you, Mayor. Councilor, I really don't know the answer to that. I will get you the answer to that. The fountain has been problematic at times, and so part of Mr. Tokarski's donation, we hope will correct some of the problematic issues. But if we have kept track of the costs, I'll send out an email to the council with what those costs have been.
Okay, thanks.
Councilor McCoy.
So following up then, Peter, that's in a budget somewhere to maintain that and has been on an ongoing basis since it was built, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I assume we're tracking it. I mean, it may just be under irrigation or, you know, so I'm hopeful that we've tracked the repair of the spray fountain specifically. So I'll tell you that we've either tracked it specifically or we have a guess. You know, I'll tell you. I'll caveat the number, whatever I email. So.
Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes. Okay, information reports. Any questions, comments?
Yes,
Councilor Kayser.
I had one comment, and that is on, I guess it's item 6.A. The report's difficult to read because all the columns don't fit on a page. And this is very nitpicky, but we need staff reports that are readable.
What?
The staff report we got for the, it was just a report for purchases approved. The columns don't fit all on one page. So by the time you get to the third page, it's just like one half of one column listed on there. So it's just a matter of being more consistent with the presentation of staff reports. But.
Okay. Councilor Ench, thank you for the suggestion.
Yeah, that's. Yeah. I have just a question for Lisa Anderson Ogilvy on 6C, which is the subdivision in Councilor Lewis's ward. I noticed that one of the conditions related to the slopes of the road in the two roads, one to 6% and I think one to 12 or 15%. Is that because of the topography there, that's the only way you can build roads?
Yes, that's very true. Yes, okay. So I think they asked for an adjustment to the slope and of the streets because of the topography.
And without that adjustment, it couldn't be built.
I wouldn't say it couldn't be built. There'd
but
be
it
a
would
lot
be much more,
more
grading difficult.
And
okay.
a lot of retaining walls.
So we're going to end up with maybe Director Fernandez sending more crews out there when it gets snowy. Okay, that's all I had. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, one more,
Councilor.
Also to item 6.C, I saw in the report there that West Salem Neighborhood Association is worried about traffic on Wallace and that there wasn't a traffic impact analysis completed to my understanding. And could you speak to that a bit, Director Fernandez?
I can. There are criteria for when we require traffic impact analysis. So if a development has access to an arterial, the criteria is that it needs to generate over 1,000 trips per day. Rule of thumb, that's slightly more than 10 homes. And then it varies by land use type. If it accesses a collector or a local street, then the criteria is a lot lower. And very simply is, you know, if we're less than 1,000 trips, we're probably not gonna have the development do anything. So there's no need to put an applicant through a big engineering process for nothing. So that's there are exceptions to that rule, but that's the general criteria.
Although they did do a TIA, they did do
a transportation analysis.
They did a transportation analysis, and the city traffic engineer reviewed it and agreed with it. So a lot of the comments were about existing traffic on Wallace, not really pertaining to the traffic coming from the right. Yeah.
Okay.
But now you know what the criteria is.
Thank you for that. Any other questions? Are there any other questions? Counselor Anderson, do you have something?
No, I just had a grammatical.
I couldn't hear you, so I couldn't.
No, tell. It was not worth anything.
Okay. That's, you can share with all of us now.
Yeah.
Okay. And we'll do then move on, unless there's anything further on these. Okay, move on to ordinances, first reading of ordinances.
Ordinance Bill 5-17, an ordinance relating to short-term rentals and accessory short-term rentals, creating new provisions and amending SRC 30.005, 30.010, 30.035, 30.040, 30.050, 30.055, 37.020, 37.060, 59.010, 59.405, 111.005, 111.010, 111.090, 111.095, 400.030, 400.035, 400.040, 510.005, 511.005, 512.010, 513.005, 514.005, 515.005, 520.015, 521.005, 530.040, 545.005, 555.005, 806.005, 806.015, 806.055, and 806.075.
Excellent. Very good. No one's asking to have that repeated, right?
It probably would have been easier, Mr. Mayor, to have her read the ordinances that were not affected
yeah,
by this.
Good point. Counselor McCoy.
I move the staff recommendation.
Second.
Second by Nanke. Any discussion?
And the staff recommendation
is
to schedule us for a public hearing.
Yeah. Counselor Lewis.
Yeah, I. Regarding the public hearing, it looks like the idea is to have this and possibly the one on Uber, and I think there was another public hearing scheduled for the 24th. I'm wondering if they are all necessary to be on that day.
If we can schedule one per day for testimony.
Do you want to talk to that? Must be to the agenda.
Maybe first the city attorney regarding any code requirements or charter requirements, if any.
No, there's no on this particular item. There's already been a public hearing at City Council, so you're not required to have a hearing.
Planning Commission.
At Planning Commission. And so the recommendation doesn't specify a specific date, but if you wanted to schedule that for a specific date, you're welcome to. That follows for the next ordinance too, regarding transportation network companies. No hearing is required on that one either, but you can schedule it for any date you like.
What about the pending legislation that's referred to? Is there a timeline that would be?
The Airbnb one is what we're talking about now.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
That's the next.
Yes.
I guess this is not a point of order, but a point of clarification. I have a number of questions, and I don't know if it's appropriate to ask them now or to wait to the public hearing when the staff is here and makes a presentation. Because I would guess that some of my questions might be answered by the presentation, and then we will also have the staff here prepared to answer them. So I'm happy to avoid my questions
great.
For now.
I think that's probably the best way to do it at this point. Councilor Nanke.
Yeah, and if you could forward those questions to staff, they'll be ready for you then.
I certainly can do that.
Okay. So we have a motion on the table. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion passes. Okay. Next.
Ordinance Bill 3-17, an ordinance relating to vehicles for hire, amending SRC 30.001 and SRC 30.005, repealing SRC 30.700 through 30.725, SRC 30.740, SRC 30.745, SRC 30.800, SRC 30.805, SRC 30.810, and SRC 30.820, creating new provisions, SRC 30.700, SRC 30.705, SRC 30.710, SRC 30.715, SRC 30.720, SRC 30.725, SRC 30.730, SRC 30.735, SRC 30.740, SRC 30.745, SRC 30.750, SRC 30.800, SRC 30.805, SRC 30.810, SRC 30.815, SRC 30.820, SRC 30.825, SRC 30.830, SRC 30.835, SRC 30.840, and SRC 30.845, renumbering SRC 30.730, SRC 30.735, SRC 30.750, SRC 30.815, and SRC 30.825.
Great, thank you. Councilor McCoy.
I move the staff recommendation to conduct a public hearing.
Second.
Second by Nanke. Okay, any discussion?
My only discussion would be, not only am I impressed that she read all those flawlessly, but I'm impressed with the attorney's office. They found all those different places to amend to get this right. So between the two, it's pretty impressive.
It's piecework. Okay, any discussion? Yes.
I guess point of clarification. So when these are scheduled, are we setting the schedule or does staff set the schedule? I guess I want to talk about if we want to have these on the same day or not. Because I personally would prefer not to have, right. I think they're both going to attract large audiences.
I agree wholeheartedly with Councilor Kayser.
We have had conversations about this, and I would tell you that we will have one and then we will have the other on a different date. These are too big to try to do all at once. It's a long evening. I think the manager might agree. Unless you have objections to that.
No, that's fine. I just wasn't sure if we needed to set a date tonight or if that can be.
It would help, I think, if you would allow the manager to set the schedule just because it allows him to put together.
That's fine.
Okay. Councilor Anderson.
Thank you. Councilor Cook asked the question earlier in response to another item on the agenda, but I am curious as to how what's going on in the state legislature right now could affect this. I mean, what's going to happen with that? Do we know where it is? And if it does pass, are we preempted? And
yeah,
I just don't know the answer to that.
Yeah, Councilor, I'll answer that for you. I think you would be, it's a mistake to base our actions on any kind of legislative action between now and July. I would just suggest, I sat through the hearing and testified on behalf of the city council on this. I really think the bill's not going anywhere, I'll just be honest with you. But. The bill is quite similar to what ours looks like. We can go ahead without it if it were to pass, and I'll tell you, it would be one of those amazing moments. I think it would override our, it would preempt our
local control.
Wait a second, it's preempt us.
So it's, but I can tell you right now, I don't think that's going anywhere right now.
A follow-up question. I have the same situation here as I did on the other ordinance. I have a lot of questions, and once again, I will hold those until I'll ask the staff to address some of them, and I'll also wait till we have the public hearing.
Yeah, and I would expect this one to be heard on the 24th. Okay.
So I'll go there first. I thought we were letting the city manager set the agenda.
I just did.
Okay. So I will ask these questions before I ask the other.
Okay. Yeah, and that would be helpful, I'm sure, to get those in to make sure we understand them. Okay? All those in favor, is there further discussion? I'm sorry. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion passes. And we have one more.
Ordinance Bill 8-17, an ordinance vacating a portion of right-of-way located south of Almsville Highway Southeast and east of Kubler Boulevard Southeast.
Councilor McCoy? Oh, Councilor Nanke, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'd move staff recommendation.
Second.
And again, this was the public hearing we had last meeting on the old right-of-way that's on the Mill Creek Corporate Center property, and this would advance that to second reading. Okay. So that it can take place for that vacation.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion passes. We have a second reading.
Ordinance Bill 4-17, an ordinance relating to changes to the Salem Area Comprehensive Plan Map designation and the Neighborhood Plan Map designation for 4220, 4230, and 4240 Sunnyview Road Northeast.
Councilor Six. Hoy. Would you like to make the motion on this?
I move staff recommendations.
No, we don't, do we? I'm sorry. Oh, I just wanted to hear you do it. It was beautiful. It was a beautiful day. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Okay. You want to do the roll call?
Of course you do.
Councilor Cook?
Aye.
Councilor Lewis?
Yes.
Councilor Kaser?
Yes.
Councilor Anderson?
Aye.
Councilor Nanke?
Aye.
Councilor McCoy?
Aye.
Councilor Osick?
Aye.
Councilor Hoy?
Aye.
Mayor Bennett?
Aye. Motion passes. The ordinance passes. And okay, we're down to public comment on issues that are not on the agenda. Was there anyone waiting to speak to the council? Okay, seeing no one, no further business.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Just the new website's online. Actually, I'm shutting down my system, but just wanted to say it looks great. I need to figure out a better way to find where our agendas are, because that was difficult for me.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, we are adjourned.